Mark chapter 11, starting in verse 1. When they came to Jerusalem unto Bethpage and Bethany at the Mount of Olives, he sendeth forth two of his disciples, and saith unto them, Go your way into the village over against you, and as soon as you be entered into it, you shall find a colt tied, whereupon never man said, Loose him, and bring him. And if any man say unto you, Why do you this? Say you that the Lord hath need of him. And straightway he will send him hither.
And they went their way and found a colt tied by the door without in a place where two ways met, crossroads, and they loosed him. And certain of them that stood there said unto them, Why, what do you? Loosen the colt. Well, what would anybody say? You know, why are you getting in my car and driving it off? I mean, you know. What do you? Loosen the colt. And they said unto him, Even as Jesus had commanded, and they let them go. And they brought the colt to Jesus and cast their garments on him, and he sat upon him. By the way, provision has to be sanctified unto him. See, it's not wrong to ask, well, what are you doing with the colt? The colt belongs to you. But if you're really a steward, all of your possessions belong to him. And if it's really for his use, then that's fine. And so apparently these guys were stewards of the Lord. And if the Lord had need of it, okay, that's all we need to know. Okay, getting back to this. So they brought the colt to Jesus, and they cast their garments on him, and he sat upon them. Many spread their garments in the way, and others cut down branches off the trees and strawed them in the way. And they went before, and they that followed, crying, saying, Hosanna! Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Blessed be the kingdom of our father David that cometh in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. And Jesus entered into Jerusalem. He goes into the temple. And he looks around at everything. And when he comes out, you can tell he's not happy with what he saw. And now the eventide was come. He went out unto Bethany with the 12. And on the morrow, when they were come from Bethany, he was hungry. And seeing a fig tree afar off, having leaves, he came, if happily, or that means perchance, he might find anything thereon. And when he came to it, he found nothing but leaves. For the time of figs was not yet. And Jesus answered and said unto it, it what? The tree. No man eat fruit of thee hereafter forever. And his disciples heard it. They came to Jerusalem, and at that moment everything was fine. The tree didn't look any different. Okay? And they came to Jerusalem. Now notice, the day before he had looked around the temple. He went inside. He looked around. He's had 24 hours. He's back at the temple again. Notice this. Jesus went into the temple, and he began to cast out them that sold and bought in the temple. He overthrew the tables of the money changers and the seats of them that sold doves. He would not suffer that any man should carry any vessel through the temple. And he taught, saying unto them, Is it not written, My house shall be called of all nations the house of prayer, but you have made it a den of thieves. Another version says, merchandising. You've made it merchandising. Okay. And the scribes and the chief priests heard it, and they sought how they might destroy him, for they feared him, because all the people was astonished at his doctrine. And when the evening was come, they went out of the city. So now get the picture. First time they went, he rode in on the donkey. He went in, he looked all around the temple. When they left that evening, they went by this fig tree, of all things. Went by this fig tree. There's only leaves on it, no fruit. He cursed that thing. Said, No man eat fruit of thee again forever. Right? They go back to Jerusalem. Now we know what he didn't like. They've taken the house of God and make it a house of merchandise. They're buying and selling, and it's not at all producing the fruit that God intended that it produce. What kind of tree did he talk to? Did you notice? Fig tree. The fig tree has always been the symbol of Israel. It's always been the the symbol of the Jewish nation. It has to do with the temple worship. It has to do with animal sacrifice. It has to do with the law of Moses. It's a fig tree. He didn't pick an apricot tree. He didn't pick an apple tree. There's all kinds of trees. He specifically chose a fig tree. And he spoke to that one, and he said, no man's going to eat fruit of thee again forever. So he goes in there. He doesn't like what he saw. He drives out the money changers out of the temple. Okay? Verse 20 now. And in the morning, as they passed by, they saw the fig tree dried up from the roots. Do words have any power? Do words affect inanimate objects that have no reasoning power? Do words have an effect on things that have no choice? Yeah. We have been given dominion that we barely know anything about. All right, let's keep going. In the morning as they passed by, they saw the fig tree dried up from the roots. And Peter, calling to remembrance, saith unto him, Master, behold the fig tree which thou cursed is withered away. And here Jesus teaches this famous passage on faith. Jesus answering saith unto them, have faith in God. But that's okay. The Greek literally says, have the faith of God. One translation, I'm not sure how pure this one is, but it's close. Have God's own faith. What he's trying to tell them, this is how God functions. Now, we're not going to turn there, but you all know the story so well. If we went back to Genesis 1 and read chapter 1, how does God do what he does? He speaks. When before man was on the earth and there was no resistance, there's no doubt, there's no unbelief at all, God speaks and it happens. This is the faith of God. We know that there's a triune God. One God revealed in three parts, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. God the Father, as I understand it, he conceives or plans everything. God the Son, God the Word, he speaks everything. And then the Holy Spirit, he is the one, he's the one I call the molecule changer. He's the one that manifests everything. But if you break it down to its basic element, John's Gospel, in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. All things were created by him. Without him was not anything made that was made. No, not one single thing in the Greek. Well, why? Because the Holy Spirit does not work apart from God's Word. Have the faith of God. Well, how does God function? God speaks, and it is. He's saying, be like that. You have got to start being like that. When you speak, you have to expect. Your faith is like your father's faith. When you speak, it happens. Even if you speak to something that has no sense, has no logic, has no brain, like cancer. I threw that in. I could say here the tree. If I want to stay strictly scriptural, a tree. It's got no choice. The tree is not resisting you. But trust me, most people speaking to a tree has no effect whatsoever. Why? Because the Holy Spirit's not co-laboring with them. The reason your words have power is that the Holy Spirit enforces what you say. We'll let that sink in for just a minute. Your will has to line up with God's will. You have to be about your Father's business in this whole thing. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you, first and foremost. So what in the world is going on with this fig tree? Now, I'm going to go ahead and read what Jesus said, but now, and we'll come back to it, but you got to get this in the context. He totally explains this following here. Let's pick it up in verse 20 again. In the morning, as they passed by, they saw the fig tree dried up from the roots. And Peter, calling to remembrance, saith unto him, Master, behold the fig tree, which thou cursed, is withered away. Jesus answering saith unto him, have faith in God, or have the faith of God. Verily I say unto you, that whosoever shall say unto this mountain, be thou removed, and be thou cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe that those things which he saith shall come to pass, he shall have whatsoever he saith. Therefore, based on that, I say unto you, what things soever you desire, when you pray, boy, if you underline, believe. All things are possible to him that believes. So what things soever you desire when you pray, believe that you receive them and you shall have them. And when you stand praying, forgive. Now you just get it straight. None of this works unless you're going to forgive. No, we have become that people. Father, forgive them. They know not what they do. It's just who we are now. No grudges, no bitterness. I don't care what they did to you. I don't care what they've done. Now, forgiveness is different than trust. You got to understand that. Forgiveness is free by the blood of Jesus. Trust is earned. Okay? That's two different things. But we're not going to be a people that walks around with bitterness and unforgiveness in our heart and think this is going to work. It's not. So when you stand praying, forgive if you have aught against any, that your Father also, which is in heaven, may forgive you your trespasses. How many wants that? Hallelujah. But if you do not forgive, neither will your Father, which is in heaven, forgive your trespasses. Now let's leave it in the context. Okay. Now what happened before? He went into the temple. He looked around. He wasn't obvious. Okay. We don't know at that point what it is, but when he left there, he speaks to the fig tree. No man eat fruit of you again forever. Next day he goes back in the temple. We see kind of what, or at least part of what he was upset about. They had taken God's house and made it into a den of thieves, a house of merchandise, or made it into a money-making scheme. None of that going on in religion today. And so when he comes out of there, and they watched all of this, you know, they watched all of this, the disciples. And when they come out, they go by that fig tree, and that thing has withered up from the roots. And they go, wow, look at that thing. Well, he tells them these principles, and that's Mark 11, 22, 23, 24. This is how we're going to function also. But let's, why did he do it? Why did he do that? Let's keep reading. See, verse 27 starts with our familiar word. And. It's not over yet. And they come again to Jerusalem. And as he was walking in the temple, here he is again, back in the temple. This has everything to do with the temple and the fig tree and the Jewish nation and the covenant that they had. There came to him the chief priests and the scribes and the elders, and they say unto him, by what authority? Now remember, yesterday he drove out the money changers. And they're going, who gave you authority to do that? And who gave thee this authority to do these things? Jesus answered and said unto them, well, I'll ask one of you one question, and you answer me, and I'll tell you by what authority I do these things. The baptism of John, talking about John the Baptist, was it from heaven or of men? Answer me. Someday I'm going to do a message titled, Don't Mess with Jesus. I love him. They reasoned within themselves saying, oh, if we shall say from heaven, well, he will say, then why did you not believe him? But if we shall say it's of men, they feared the people, for all men counted John that he was a prophet indeed. And they answered and said unto Jesus, well, we can't tell. Jesus answering saith unto them, neither do I tell you by what authority I do these things. Now, there should not be a division here, the chapter division. And he began to speak unto them by parables. Now, here he gives the explanation about the fig tree. A certain man planted a vineyard, and he set a hedge about it, and digged a place for the wine fat, and built a tower, and let it out to husbandmen, and went into a far country. And at the season he sent to the husbandmen a servant, that he might receive from the husbandmen of the what? Of the fruit of the vineyard. What was the thing about the fig tree? It had leaves, but no fruit. Now, he purposely picked out one. He said it's not the time of fruit yet. He's making a visual demonstration of what he's about to do. He's bringing the first covenant to an end because it's not bearing fruit. It's not bearing the fruit of the new birth. It's not producing in the earth what God wants. And that whole fig tree thing was it's like a classroom where you'll do a demonstration for the kids to help them understand what you're trying to teach them. He's showing them by cursing this fig tree, God's bringing this first covenant to a close. He's bringing this first covenant to a close. Because it, why? It's not producing fruit. So he's telling them here. Verse 2, and at the season he sent to the husbandman a servant, that he might receive from the husbandman of the fruit of the vineyard. And they caught him, and they beat him, and they sent him away empty. And again he sent unto them another servant. And at him they cast stones, and wounded him in the head, and sent him away shamefully handled. He's talking about the prophets of the Old Testament. He's talking about all these prophets, these servants of God that came, trying to bring Israel to repentance, so that there could be fruit. And they killed him. They would stone and kill the prophets. And again he sent another, and him they killed, and many others, beating some and killing some, having yet therefore one son. Having yet therefore one son, his well-beloved, he sent him also last unto them, saying, they will reverence my son. But those husbandmen, they said among themselves, this is the heir. Come, let us kill him, and the inheritance shall be ours. Now, we're going to finish this. In the context, religion found out it could make money off of God's people. And what they're saying is, uh-oh, here comes God's son, the real heir. But if we kill him, we can keep fleecing the sheep like they were our own. They took him and killed him and cast him out of the vineyard. What shall therefore the Lord of the vineyard do? He will come and destroy the husbandman and will give the vineyard unto others. He will give the vineyard unto others. The Gentiles are the others, if you want to know the truth of it. He will give the vineyard unto others. And have you not read this scripture? The stone which the builders rejected is become the head of the corner. This was the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes. They understood what he was saying. They sought to lay hands on him, but feared the people, for they knew that he had spoken the parable against them. And they left him and went their way. Now we could go on there. Turn over to Hebrews. I want to show you that what's going on here in Hebrews chapter 10. Got to remember, the writer of the letter to Hebrews, which many think is Paul. I'm not a scholar enough to tell. Sounds like Paul to me. But whoever it was that wrote this letter to the Hebrews, you got to remember the context that he wrote it in. The reason that it's called Hebrews, it was a letter to the Jews. These were people that had gotten born again. They grew up, though, in a Jewish household. Mom and Dad, how do I please God? Well, you keep the law, son. That's how you please God. You do your best to keep the law. And if you sin or make a mistake, then you check with the law and you find the appropriate lamb or the appropriate sacrifice, whatever it is. And then you offer that to God. He receives that and your sins are blotted out. That's how you please God. Keep the law. Well, then someone comes and preaches Christ unto them, that he is the lamb, that his once and for all sacrifice paid for all of the sin of mankind. You no longer trust in your ability to keep the law. You put your trust rather in the finished work of Jesus Christ. And they legitimately really got born again. But then great pressure was put on them. That's Mark 4. Persecution and affliction for the word's sake. You remember? For the word's sake. And their own parents would come against them. This still happens today in Jewish households. They'll say, if you don't reject this Jesus and go back to the God of Moses, well, I'm going to have a mock funeral. We'll bury an empty casket and I'll say you was in it. I'll say, I have no son, and that the inheritance you would have received from me and your mom, I'm going to distribute it amongst your brethren. You reject this Jesus and go back. That was the kind of pressure that they were under. And this whole letter to the Hebrews, don't do that. Do not reject Jesus. You can't, what he's really telling them, there is no covenant to go back to. And that's Hebrews 10. Now look at this. Starting in verse 1 of Hebrews 10. For the law. If you underline, please underline the word law. What's the subject here? The law. The law of Moses. Now he's not really talking about the Abrahamic covenant here. That's a different thing. But he is talking about the law of Moses. the covenant that God made with Israel on Mount Sinai. Okay? For the law, having a shadow of good things to come, and not the very image of the things, can never with those sacrifice which they offered year by year continually make the comers thereunto perfect. For then would they not have ceased to be offered, because that the worshippers, once purged, should have had no more conscience of sins. But in those sacrifices there is a remembrance again made of sins every year. For it is not possible that the blood of bulls and of goats should take away sins. Wherefore, when he cometh into the world, he saith, sacrifice and offering thou wouldest not, but a body thou hast prepared me. This is speaking of Jesus. In burnt offerings and sacrifices for sin, thou hast had no pleasure. Then said I, lo, I come. In the volume of the book it is written of me to do what? To do thy will, O God. Above, when he said, sacrifice and offering and burnt offerings and offering for sin thou wouldest not, neither had pleasure therein which are offered by the law. Then said he, lo, I come to do thy will, O God. Now, if you underline this sentence. He taketh away the first, that he may establish the second. He taketh away the first, that he may establish the second. That's the same thing he was illustrating with the fig tree. Boys, this system, this first covenant, this covenant of the law made with Moses at Mount Sinai, represented by the fig tree, the temple, the animal sacrifices, and all that that is, no man is going to eat fruit off of that tree again forever. I am cutting it off at the root. He is going to be the ultimate sacrifice, the once and for all lamb put on that cross. And if we continue, you'd find out through that one offering, we have been sanctified forever. Through that blood is still on the mercy seat today. And you can still go to that blood when you miss it even now. He said, now look at it again, verse 9. He taketh away the first. What is the first? It's the first covenant. It's specifically the law of Moses he's talking about here. The law, he's taken that away. It does no good anymore to offer a sheep. Really, that's an insult to God. You're going to offer an animal's blood now when his son has already shed his blood? Come on, are you going to mingle sheep blood on the altar, are you, with his blood? It's ridiculous. It's ridiculous. And going back to the fig tree, that's really what he was saying. Jesus was not doing what he was doing for personal profit. He was not doing it to show off. He was not doing it to, look at me, I'm special. He was not doing it to play with holy things and power. No. He was completely sold out to the will of his Father, knowing that he himself was going to give his own life as the fulfillment of the old covenant, to be the ultimate lamb offered on the altar of God, that it would bring that first covenant to an end. No man would ever eat of that fig tree again. No. There's only death there now. There's nothing there. There's no other. That's what this letter to the Hebrews is. He's telling them there is no first covenant to go back to. You don't really have the choice of Jesus or the law of Moses. He's taken away the first that he may establish the second.
If you really want to know the truth, the sin of the religious leaders of Jesus' day was this. They so held to the God of Moses. I'm talking about the Pharisees and the Sadducees. They only understood a God of judgment, a God of law, and a God of war. That's all they knew. When Jesus came to reveal God the Father, they rejected the message, and they rejected the messenger. Therefore, they could never understand, they could never enter in to what Jesus, the truth and grace Jesus was trying to bring, because they rejected Jesus, who came to reveal the Father. The problem with our generation is, for the most part, religious leaders today have rejected the Holy Spirit, who has been sent to reveal Christ. As the Holy Spirit reveals and unveils the mind of Christ in us, that's when we truly have access to the Father. And that's really what Jesus meant when he says, I am the way, the truth, the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. And the Holy Spirit, his job is to unveil Christ to you so that you can enter in and by him have full access to the Father, his grace, and everything that is his. Hallelujah. Does that sound good?
Yeah.
Would you say Jesus, concerning the fig tree, completely destroyed that fig tree? I mean, it's plucked up by the roots. If you pluck something up by the roots, it's dead. That thing is destroyed. Nobody will ever eat fruit off of that fig tree again. Now, he was doing that as a visual demonstration to explain to us so that they would understand what he was about to do to this religious system. The religious system that was supposed to be a house of prayer. A religious system where people were supposed to be able to come and find God. A religious system which was God's best on the earth at the time. He had given them the temple with the Holy of Holies that has the very presence of God in it. But yet when he came to the temple, he found no fruit. Rather than finding a house of prayer, what did he find? A den of thieves, money changers. Money changers. It had become a house of merchandise. And they were using religion to make merchandise of the people. Now I want to show you something. We're talking about the destruction of a fruitless religious system. Jesus says it's coming down. I'm going to destroy it completely, plucked up by the roots. It will be totally destroyed. Okay, what he was doing as a visual demonstration with the fig tree, he says out of his mouth in Mark 13, starting in verse 1. And as he went out of the temple, one of his disciples saith unto him, Master, see what manner of stones and what buildings are here. And Jesus answering said unto them, Seest thou these great buildings? There shall not be left one stone upon another that shall not be thrown down. He's telling them what he showed them when he cursed the fig tree. This fruitless religious system is coming to an end, and no man is ever going to eat fruit of it again. Can you see that? He has not changed the subject all the way to chapter 13. Men had changed the word of God into a system of stealing from the people. Den of thieves. What does thieves mean to you? Thieves steal, don't they? And they were using religion to steal from God's people. All right, now watch this, just to show you he's still talking about that. Mark chapter 12, verse 38. And he said unto them in his doctrine, Beware of the scribes, which love to go in long clothing, and love salutations in the marketplaces, and the chief seats in the synagogues, and the uppermost rooms at feasts. Now watch this. Which devour widows' houses, and for a pretense make long prayers. These shall receive greater damnation. Devouring widows' houses. Would you call that stealing? I'd call that stealing. Somehow, now the scribes, who are they? See, not every Pharisee was a scribe. A scribe was a chief Pharisee. They were experts of the law. They were the ones you would go to them and you say, where does it say thus and so? And boy, they could tell you right where it was. They were the experts of the religion. And he says, beware their doctrine, because they wind up devouring widows' houses. Now, in order to show them, again, let me tell you, Jesus is big on visual demonstrations. Verse 41, And Jesus sat over against the treasury, and beheld how the people cast money into the treasury. And many that were rich cast in much. And there came a certain poor widow, and she threw in 2 mites, which make a farthing. And he called unto them his disciples, and saith unto them, Verily I say unto you, that this poor widow hath cast in more than all they which have cast into the treasury. For all they did cast in of their abundance. But she did of her want, did cast in all that she had, even all her living. Now he just got through telling them, beware the scribes. The end result is, they devour a widow's houses. And they're doing a pretty good job on this one. They just got the last of all of her living. Now, who is it that Jesus is concerned about here? Who is it he's looking out for? The widow. You got to understand that. Jesus is for this widow. And he's saying, I am warning you, boys. Boys, men, you're going to follow me. I'm telling you, don't pay attention to the doctrine being preached by these scribes. Because if you do what they're doing, you're going to wind up just like them, and you're going to become thieves in God's house, and you're going to devour widows' houses. Now follow me, let me show you how they're doing it. And he takes them right into the temple, right into the treasury, and he shows them a widow whose living is being devoured. Now I know you've heard it preached all your life, just like I have, that this is a wonderful example of how to give. This is an example of how to have your living devoured. And in our day, we are so blind by the darkness. We read this and hooray what's going on, thinking it's the mind of Christ. Right after he says that she has cast in all her living, and as he went out of the temple, that's when he says, seest thou these great buildings? This is what made him so mad. This kind of practice is why, he says, I'm bringing this system down. I'm telling you, not one stone is going to be left on top of another. Religious cons are coming down. All right, let me show you a copy of the message that Jesus preached to these guys. This is how the Holy Ghost showed me. He showed me the text of the message that Jesus preached while he was here. Mark chapter 13. Now watch this. And as he went out of the temple, one of his disciples saith unto him, Master, see what manner of stones and what buildings are here. And Jesus answering said unto him, Seest thou these great buildings? There shall not be left one stone upon another that shall not be thrown down. And as he sat upon the Mount of Olives over against the temple, Peter and James and John and Andrew asked him privately, so forth and so on. Now, you hear that? Back up to Matthew chapter 24. See if this sounds familiar. Matthew 24, starting in verse 1. And Jesus went out and departed from the temple, and his disciples came to him for to show him the buildings of the temple. And Jesus said unto them, See ye not all these things? Verily I say unto you, there shall not be left one stone upon another that shall not be thrown down. And as he sat upon the Mount of Olives and so forth, does that sound familiar to you? That's the same incident. Everything about it, even going to the Mount of Olives and everything. Matthew recorded the message that Mark did not. So I started backing up, looking in this. Look at all this red back up here, all the way to the beginning of chapter 23. This is the message that he preached. He was so mad. He was so mad at what he saw. This is a scathing message. Don't have time to teach it all. It's loaded with revelation knowledge. But let's start in verse 13. Who did Jesus say to beware of? Scribes. Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites! For you shut up the kingdom of heaven against men. For you neither go in yourselves, neither suffer ye them that are entering to go in. Again he says, Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites! I love Jesus. The day, woe unto you, you hypocrite! For you devour, what? For you devour widows' houses. And for a pretense make long prayer. Therefore you shall receive the greater damnation. Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees. Preachers of today, if you hear this tape, you better listen. You better be careful what doctrine you're preaching. Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites. For you compass sea and land to make one proselyte. And when he is made, you make him twofold more the child of hell than yourselves. Woe unto you, you blind guides, whose minds are still covered with the darkness of this world system, who still think with the thinking processes of Satan. That was free. But when he says blind guides, that's what he means. They're still living in darkness. They're blind. They haven't seen the light yet. Which say, now get this. I told you. Now watch this. You blind guides would say, whosoever shall swear by the temple, that's nothing. But whosoever shall swear by the gold of the temple, he's a debtor. In other words, that counts. You fools and blind, for whether is greater, the gold or the temple that sanctifies the gold? And whosoever shall swear by the altar, they say, it is nothing. Get this. But whosoever shall swear by the gift that is upon it, he is guilty. And that just means he's bound now. He's a debtor. You fools and blind. For whether is greater, the gift or the altar that sanctifies the gift? And I could go on and on and on here. This is a scathing message. That altar, what was the altar in the temple a type of? The sacrifice of the lamb. And he's saying, see, Jesus knows who the sacrificial lamb is. He's going to be on the true altar just a few years from this date. It's not going to be long. He himself is going to be on the altar bearing the poverty of all mankind. And he's saying, what are you saying to these people? What's more important, their gifts or the altar where I bore their poverty? Thank God for today. Verse 20. We'll read that again. Whosoever therefore shall swear by the altar, sweareth by it and by all things thereon. And whosoever shall swear by the temple. What is the temple? The temple is the house of God. Sweareth by it and by him that dwelleth therein. He that shall swear by heaven sweareth by the throne of God and by him that sitteth thereon. Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites! For you pay tithe of mint and anise and cumin, and have omitted the weightier matters of the law, judgment, mercy, and faith. Were they exhibiting any judgment, any mercy, or any faith towards this widow at all? No, but they sure taught her how to tithe right down to the last powder of her mint and her cumin. These ought you to have done, and not to leave the other undone, you blind guides, which strain at a gnat and swallow a camel. You know what that means? I wondered for a long time what that meant. I prayed and I prayed and I prayed. You may have been in a service like this, where they come and they to the people. These are the experts, remember, the scribes. They are the best of the best, the religious leaders, when it comes to their knowledge. But when the people would come together, even though they have devoured whole volumes of the word themselves, when it comes to the people, we'll give you a little, just a little taste, a little gnat. Here's just a little something to take home. They're not feeding the people at all. Even though, now, another rendering of it could be, you come and we'll give you a 10-minute message, but we're going to devour your living while you're here. It could be either one, I'm not sure. Either one's bad. Woe unto you, verse 25. Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites! For you make clean the outside of the cup and of the platter, but within they are full of extortion and excess. Extortion means robbery by force. You're full of robbery by force. You're stealing from the people. You are extorting from them. You're not giving them a choice by your doctrine. All right? Now let's analyze this for a minute. Let's think about this. What Jesus said is this. Beware these scribes. What they're teaching He doesn't like what he sees happening to the widow. Okay? Now, what got her into this trouble? The doctrine of the scribes. Now, what kind of doctrine would produce this? Jesus sat over against the treasury and beheld how the people cast money into the treasury. And many that were rich cast in much. You ought to underline that. Much means they were putting large sums of money into the offering. Okay, that's important. They were putting in out of their abundance. I mean, they could afford it. But there's still no denying the fact they were putting in large amounts. That's what stood out to me first. All right, now let's keep going. And there came a certain poor widow. And she threw in two mites, which make a farthing. And we know from reading later on, he says that's all she had. He cast in all of her living. Why would she do that? I kept meditating and praying. The rich people put in much, and the widow woman, even though she's poor, she put in all. The rich put in much. The widow woman, she put in all, even though it was a small amount. What kind of doctrine would produce that? A doctrine that says your blessing from God depends on how much you give. When Jesus turned around and made this statement in verse 43, and he said unto his disciples, I want you to know that Jesus was upset and astonished without measure. If you could see the countenance on his face when he turned and said this, I'm sure it was the same look he had when he made that scourge and drove the money changers from the temple. He was upset because he looked at them and he said, Verily I say unto you that this poor widow hath cast more in than all they which have cast into the treasury. For all they did cast in of their abundance, but she of her want did cast in all that she had, even all her living. Now, Jesus, do you think he knows the Old Testament? I mean, dear God, he is the Old Testament. Jesus is the Word, is he not? You know what he's saying to them? Now, these guys know the Word. They were raised, they're Jews. They've lived in, grew up with that. You know what he's saying? Where does it say in the Old Testament widows are to cast in all of their living? But where did these scribes come up with that doctrine? God the Father, it always has been based on percentage. That way it's fair to all the people. Put in a certain percentage. Where does it say that the rich are supposed to put in a very small percentage out of their abundance? And the burden of the temple is supposed to be borne on the backs of poor widows. And they're to cast in all that they have. Where did they come up with this doctrine? He is upset. Where they come up with it is the love of money. Because what they're after, they could care less about that widow. See, the very next thing, right there they got her last penny. What's next? Your house. He's not kidding. The only thing she's got left is wherever she's living. But all she knows is what she's been taught. And the doctrine of the scribes that she's been taught is God only blesses you when you give deep enough to move your faith. How close are we to destruction of some religious systems today? You mark my words. We've entered into the last days. This kind of trash has got to stop. And the true mind of God and the true anointing of God and how he truly prospers his people, which, by the way, in our covenant, whatever he says to you, do it. That is the only way he's going to prosper you. You can get formulas. You can do formulas. You can listen to them till your eyeballs or your ears fall off. It is not going to work for you. Those that are the sons of God, they're led by the Spirit of God. No, 10% does not belong to God. That's the Old Testament. That's his servants, not his brothers and his sisters. The Bible says we are joint heirs with him. You understand that? You are bone of his bone, flesh of his flesh. You've been bought with a price. Your life is not your own. I'm not even his servant anymore. I'm his slave. See, a servant works for wages. But a slave is owned. He owns me. Whatever he says to me, I'm going to do it. Whether it profits me, whether it doesn't profit me. My life is not my own anymore. I've been bought with a price. How about you? You know what I found, though? The more that I obey him, the more he prospers me. The more he prospers me. You want to know what a really prosperous man is? When you pray, he answers. You find a baby with no face, and you pray. God puts a face on that baby. That's a prosperous man. I'd rather have Jesus than silver and gold. You're never going to have prosperity till it rings true in your heart. Till you'd rather have Jesus than silver and gold. I'd rather have 1 minute in his presence. 1 minute with him flowing his anointing and his life through my veins. Than have all the gold and silver in the world. God, for him to put a face on a baby. To put a brain in one of these little children that's born with only a stem. God's a prosperous man. When you ask God Almighty, and he says, yes, that's a prosperous man. And if God can ever find a people that will seek his face enough where he can purge the love of money from us so it won't destroy us, but where we can bring it to his temple, where it can be used to accomplish his mind, he will shake the nations. It belongs to him. He'll give you such wisdom. He'll give you such joy. He'll give you such knowledge that it will shake the very foundations of this earth and bring the silver and the gold to the temple for his use for a change. Hallelujah. But see, the curse of the law was threefold and not two. Spiritual death, sickness, and poverty. And the world has yet to see the real manifestation of the third one. Jesus is Lord over all, including the finances. The earth is the Lord's, the fullness thereof, the people and all that is therein. The silver is mine, saith the Lord, and the gold is mine. And I'll shake the nations myself, and I'll bring it to my temple. Hello, temple. Hello, temple. This is a temple being built not of stones, but out of lively stones, human beings, and you are the temple of the living God. I thank God for it. God can't honor anything in the earth but his word. He does not honor good intentions. He honors his word and only his word. And when you act on his word, that's when he can move. But when the people are deceived through religion, God cannot honor anything but the truth. Father, thy word is truth. So even though the widow was sincere, she loved God. I have no doubt about that. She wanted to be blessed of God. She was a victim of the doctrine of the Pharisees. And that's why Jesus says, I'm tearing this down. Amen. This is coming down. God will not have this any longer. This system and every Pharisee in it is coming down with it. Because I'm telling you, this is a prophetic message. This is a prophetic message. That system is coming down. You recognize it, don't you? Is that what's being preached all across this land or not? And it's accomplishing enough. It's accomplishing exactly the same thing that it accomplished there. It's fattening the wallets of the preachers, and it's shearing the sheep of their wool. Think about it. The man standing as the spokesman, the mouthpiece for God, says to the sheep, God will not accept you without your gift. You don't have a choice if you want to be accepted by God. Now you have to bring your gift. To the point that widow brought all that she had. She really didn't have a choice. She was a victim of the doctrine of the Pharisees, and she wanted to please God. She wanted to be accepted by God. Their doctrine extorted all that she had, and all the time it was a bald-faced lie. God never said any such thing. Never, ever, never. under the covenant she was under. Nowhere in that covenant will you find widows. Bring all you have, then I will accept you. If anything, if you go back and study God's care for widows, he told the rich men, don't you go back and glean your fields. You pass through it one time, whatever's left, that's for the widows. On and on and on. He made all kinds of provision for the widows. Nowhere do you find anywhere that the temple is supposed to be born on the backs of the widow's mite. Oh, he was upset. Jesus was mad. He knew better than this. Where did they come up with this doctrine? Where did they find this in my Father's word? When was this a part of the covenant? Do you notice that one thing? He says, you make them twice more the son of hell than yourselves. What's going to be the ending place for these people? Do y'all remember the rich man in Lazarus? He also was a Pharisee, a type of the Pharisees, who dined sumptuously every day, probably off of the offerings that they received this way. And he just stepped right over Lazarus every day. Wouldn't so much as give him the crumbs off of his table. He could care less about Lazarus as long as he had his fine meals and all of his fine things. Do y'all remember where he wound up? In hell. I wouldn't play around with the doctrine of the scribes and the Pharisees if I was you. Preachers, any preachers hearing my voice, check your doctrine. Please. For your eternal soul's sake, I beg of you, check your doctrine. Beware the doctrine of the scribes and the Pharisees. I don't care how often you've heard it preached. I don't care how many mega preachers are preaching it on television. It's not the truth. It's not the truth. Forsake it and save your soul from damnation. The system that's going on in the church at large today is almost identical to the doctrine of these Pharisees. And that system is coming down. And all who preach it are coming down with it. They're going to be exposed as charlatans and ignorant and fools, for they do greatly err, not knowing the scriptures nor the power of God. And it is coming down. And those that will penetrate the darkness and receive the light and be willing to walk in it and trust the living God and not fall back on man's schemes, but will put their trust in the living God, they're going to walk in the light. And the wealth of this world, God prophesied in Haggai, I'm going to shake the nations. The gold is mine and the silver is mine. And I'm going to shake the nations and the desire of the Gentiles shall come into my temple and the glory of this house shall be greater than the former house. But it's only going to be for those that will forsake practices that steal from the people and shear the sheep. This only came by praying in the Holy Ghost. But I challenge you, start with that beginning verse that we started with. The one where he went into the temple and inspected it. Start there. Follow it all the way through till he says not one stone is going to be left on another. Just for your reference, that would be Mark chapter 11, starting in verse 11, all the way through Mark chapter 13, verse 2. You meditate that entire passage yourself. Read it over and over again, just like we're supposed to. Don't take a verse out of context. Refuse to take a verse out. Leave every stroke of the brush where it's supposed to be and pray in other tongues. And I'm telling you, the Holy Ghost will show you. It's for this very practice that Jesus brought down that system. And it's for these very same practices he's going to bring down what's going on in the church today. Jesus didn't like it then, and he doesn't like it now.
Yes. Yes. Amen.
Amen.